memory of never studied carefully this program, but it was done by other teams and well done. So I chose to present the results of Dakin and Kozengen and other people because I was in the jury of the thesis, so I knew the results quite well, but it was already developed by other team, especially Giletti's, Catalin, Groves, and so on, and you can find different analyses which are quite interesting. So, what they called, I remind you, for the moon, they isolate the possibility of the angles ray. You have this possibility of small omega dot for the space debris, capital omega for the space debris, and plus or minus the moon equal to zero in the frequency. You have for the sun, you have the node of the sun which is zero, so you have a reduced number of just this kind of resonances. So how to situate these resonances? They choose to situate it with respect to this well-known formula, given the approximation of the motion of the perigee and the node, just due to J2, which is the main effect. So if you see this kind of things, we can have a frequency function of the eccentricity and the inclination. Of course, if the eccentricity goes to 1, it goes to infinity. But except for that, you can use this formula for high values of sinus of inclination and eccentricity. And so, again, this was the results of Breiter. The Lily Solar, he decided to present them in the inclination omega plane. And for the dashed line, it was inclination resonance only. But, of course, we are used now to new papers presenting the thing with colors and so on. And it's easier to see these things. And it's much more complete because they divided the space in different regions. You see that the interest is again for this MAO zone because of the interest of the MAO satellites and other ones. And so you see that they really show that for different value, initial value eccentricity condition, you can have these different resonances. Here are the resonances with the moon, see? And for different values of the semi-galaxies, they could vary, disappear, extend, and so on. If you make a zoom, you can see that each of them has a width. This is not a nice or big curve. And you can have a good idea just by this picture of the possible superposition. Especially, of course, if you start with an inclination value about 30, 40 degrees. Okay, but even here, for an average value, if you're in this region, you have already several of them. So, this was a good plot, and I think they made really a good job by showing the different superposition of those eccentricities. This is the zoom of different portions of the previous ones. And I could remind you that the Galilean satellites are more or less, Galilean satellites are scheduled for 55-56 degrees, I think, or and so you can be just in the middle of this very chaotic superposition of resonances. And so they use again the FLV to see the chaotic motion, and you see that this is different from the other one, but you have these different resonances appearing everywhere, where you can measure the most chaotic and the less chaotic zone. You can try to say, I think. This is another one that I like especially. This is with the sun. You see, this is 2 omega dot plus capital omega dots, because we suspect that these lines are again secondary resonance inside of the main resonance. And we have started a collaboration with Jacob Dakin, which had finished. Maybe my fault because I'm never very free. Magda does most of the job, my PhD student. And we would like really to refine again in the lunisolar resonances, as we did for the geostationary resonance, and to try to explain this special structure, because I think they are too regular not to be 2-1, 3-1, and so on, as we suspected for the other one. So I think it's a very nice job and could be used. I do not know to make the chaos maps, I can use the chaos map for the different case. I just took two examples, but there are much more, and you can find it here. So this is what I just say. We don't know it's suspect secondary resonances. We have no answer very much. And we think that there is an analogy with other chaos representation. So what I mean, that it would be a resonance between the sigma second and another. This is the collaboration I was talking about. There is another paper with Stiganis. So that can be Stiganis. I forgot to say that the previous paper was based on the previous paper and so on. I just took the one of the last one to show you the most recent region. And this is again the region, the Galileo satellites you see about I equal to 56 degrees, and this is the zone where you can find superposition of lunates that are resonances to change and stability if you are in the crossing of two of them. This is quite a little bit annoying for the future of the constellation. There are a paper which I have not read, but I found preparing this talk. I ignore this paper, so I already read it. But I suggest if you are interested, because it's only on this resonance I have just shown it's a special analysis. But I did not know this journal, and I'm not I did not look at it. So I hope this is, if you want to say a few words about it.
I think it's public.
Okay, so you could have a look. But I discovered it. I did not know you have especially published on this resonance. But I knew, of course, the paper, the large paper, which produced all types of resonance chaos in space, which is one of the most complete papers, in which, of course, you talk about lunar solar resonances, again, defining them. But what I found is you also expect that you have a semi-circular resonances, what you call. So you have perigee, the node of the asteroids, but you do not have perigee, nodes or perigee for the moon or for the sun, but the moon is here. You get the minimum, okay, on special motion, on time motion. So you can have, again, a set of resonances. And you could superpose all the resonances together in the zones you would like to have some stability IDs. And I think this is still a big job to do, because just if you want to reduce your study to the 56 degrees in inclination, you have to manage with many, many different resonances. And all the study, mixing the chaos, the dynamics, the position of the resonance and so on, show you how it could be better. But if you want, you have always the tool to go further in one precise resonance and to analyze it as a local model and to see exactly what's happening. But this is not a good thing. The zone I suggested already yesterday, I'm seeing one more interesting zone is the 1 to 2. And if you have some PhD program for the space debris, I think it would be a nice opportunity to explore completely this zone too, because there are some projects, it seems, for this region. We started, but when my PhD left, he left with the stats and points, and I have never looked on since that. So, I would like to say a few words now about the Dirac effects. Of course, the Dirac effects is mainly atmospheric effect, and they touch only the low region, because after, say, a few hundred kilometers, it does not have. So if you want to have a space and a software with a complete dynamical approach, you have to follow your space debris up to the atmosphere, and so to see where is the reentry, where you could expect, how much time, and so on. So you have to put some Dirac in your model. So it was the job of Alexis Petit, he finished his thesis in a few days. And he analyzed different models and approaches and included them in the steps so that we could follow for a long period of time the behavior of the space debris. So mainly the the literature, but really we concentrated, or I should say he concentrated on three. The Jackie Arbourman in 2008, which is a semi-numerical model, and based on the initial, I would say, the reference one in 71, and this is now the reference in the Kostler community. So he tested another model, which is also semi-analytical, which could perhaps be more precise in some low attitude. And he also analyzed the TDIT8, which is an empirical model, which is fitted on the observation data. So no previous model before. But it's extended to very high altitude. So the density function in these different models, of course, mainly depends on the solar activity, the geomantic activity, the local current, and the latitude. They are very, very difficult to explain in details, and I don't want to do that, but just to show you the effect on the dynamics of different models. Should you choose one model more than another one, what the difference between, how to test them, and so on. But I am not going to tell you that it's better to take this data and this one is not nature. So we decided to compare the models on a real orbit. So we took two TV or two real satellites, Starlet, which is low altitude and able to be perturbed. So NIMASTEP was used with the best integrator we could have in the present implementation, and we decided to integrate for more than 20 years. First of all, there is a question of CPU time, because you see that it's not enormous, but it's 58 minutes with respect to 6 minutes. So if you want to make many, many integrations, of course there is another which is faster than the other ones. This could be your choice. And the reference model I told you by Kostler seems to be the most heavy, but perhaps also the most complete you can get. So we compare what we call the TLA, so let's say what we consider as the real motion of the space debris. Okay? And so you consider the GB model is in red, you have the GTM is in blue, and you have the TD88 in blue. And you have, besides, the difference with respect to the different models with the reference point. So what you could see is that they evolve in the same way for, let's say, almost 10 years. So for the first 10 years, if you use one of the other models, normally it should be more or less the same. But after, and especially when you're altitude is decreasing, you see that they have different slopes and that you could be, I would say, before on the Earth if you use this model and this one. And this one. So there are differences, this is true, but you can see that the general behavior is still the same. This is more quantitative than qualitative. So this is the other case, this is the stellar satellites where the difference are perhaps less visible. And you see that, again, you have the red and the blue very close to each other, and not so bad to approximate the TLA. The green is a little bit different. The green is the fast one, the empirical model, and not the semi-analytical model. So you see that it's less precise, probably could be adjusted to data to be really efficient. This is the Chinese explosion of the satellites I have mentioned several times. And so you have the number of debris due to this explosion. And so this is what the different models predict as a decreasing of the number of debris after several years. So the explosion was in 2011. And you see that this one is the prediction of the TLA, and the model we have tested. We have also tested another model given by Florent Benefli, very close to the green one. And they predict that the number of debris decreases less efficiently than one of the official observations. So they could be efficient, but perhaps a little bit pessimistic on this kind of things, because they get more time to get rid of your space debris. This is the same kind of thing with the collision with cosmos helium. This is the following of the debris of the iridium satellites. And again, in that case, you see that all the models are very, very close to each other. And then they have a good prediction of the number of debris after, let's say, 5 years that are still in the space. And they are still at, you see, they are still at 300 kilometers. They are still 300 degrees, and they are not yet. They are in a kind of phase of stabilization, and here we are going later. So, another effect now that we tried to test recently. This is a poster of Magda next week. This is to see if you have to take into account the Yarkovsky effect on space degrees, especially those with large A over M, as it was so efficient for the asteroids. Of course, it was efficient only, let's say, millions of billions of years for some cases. But I remember before Yarkovsky, there were no really good explanation how the asteroids could move for a long time but to the resonances, then to be excited by the resonances and perhaps become Earth encounters and things like this. And this Yarkovsky effect was really the, let me say, the stone, the point to understand that there were slow effects that they could affect the orbits on a very long time. So, for artificial satellites, I don't think that's really an effect. I think so. And I would like, we wanted to test it for the space debris. So this is a thermal effect, I don't know if you are used to, due to the fact that the satellite is spinning, so it gets warmed, and it's scalding and warming, and one after the other one, and this superposition of difference of temperature has an effect on its orbit. We are interested in the Yarkovsky-Schatz effect because it causes long-term semi-analysis variation, but only when you have the Earth's shadow. Why? Because if not, there is an averaging of the perturbation and you don't see any effect. But if you have the Earth's shadow phenomena, you stop the signal and have the signal again, and so on an orbit, you have not this average, it goes to zero. So this, one, we have, this is why we have chosen this phenomena, and so we try to see its importance with respect to the other perturbation. So, and again, we propose this map, and it seems that for the radial component of the acceleration, you see this Yarkovsky effect is here. So you have the Jupiter in yellow, right? And you have the Yarkovsky, which is, in fact, norm, still less important than the Jupiter's perturbation of the space. But anyway, we wanted to see which kind of perturbation could give, and so we performed several perturbation, Magda did, maybe. And so you can, as a parameter, the spin of the rotation of the satellites, to have this effect different. So you have the comparison of the amplitude of the semi-analysis, and they depend on the rotation period of the satellite. You have 20 hours, this is the magenta. You see, you have 9 hours, 2 hours, or 1,000 seconds. So the blackers make the orbits, when you have only the sun, and you have the sun plus the Yarkovsky. So you could see that some perturbations are present in a few kilometers on your orbit, and special spin ratio, particularly efficient for this kind of effect. This is the time evolution of different orbits again, with respect to time and semi-analysis of different models. And this is a variation in eccentricity with respect to the sun. So you see that it's a very, very light, I would say. But of course, the eccentricity is itself is at the beginning having some effect, and after it disappears. Again, the different colors does not make a lot of difference, as you can see. The different spins of the different asteroids is not an important part. So we are still investigating, but we think that it's not really at the moment an effect to include in the dynamical model as a quantitative point of view. I mean, to have a really an influence on the dynamics. But it could help in some cases to give you some special behavior of the swimming artist exactly at the right moment. But I don't think that at the moment it's one of the effects when you neglect other important effects in your model that you have to take care about the reactors. But anyway, I'll wait for further results, and you will have more details if you're interested in the on the poster on my next week. So the last topic I wanted to talk with you is my dream for the synthetic population. So I'm in a, I'll give you the context. I am in a Naxis Institute of System Complex in a mathematics department, and we had to from institute, and so to find something which gathers all of the applied research, which was complex systems, that's dynamical, optimization, statistical, and so on. They are all complex. And so you can be taken by theories, application, and fields, and so on, could be different. And one of the research group is specialist in mobility and traffic. They model the traffic of the different city and so on, more than 40 years of experience. And in the beginning, they started with the S-car algorithm, shortest paths, and things like this, in a graph, in a network, and it was very, very mathematical. But with the years, they have to make inquiries about the behavior of the people. It's not because the shortest path is this one, but the people are going to take it. So this is a very, very important, especially in magnetics, that they have their own ideas, and they don't follow what the algorithm should say, that is that. Shortest part. And so they had really to extend the study about human behavior, and they needed huge data to compare the behavior of the people with the real behavior of the people, and they needed data to know how much families, how many people in your family, where are you going to school, where do you live, the supermarket, where are you going. And in Belgium, there is a private life about private life. And you're not allowed to make inquiries when you want, asking personal questions to the people. They don't have to tell you where they are going to the supermarkets and so on. This is private. So they have local studies for the city or something like this, or they found them somewhere, some data, but 10 years ago and so on. And they were. It was impossible for them to have an idea about the Belgian population, let's say 10 millions of people. So they built, step by step, a virtual population. It means a population which seems to be the real one, but no one's a real individual. Okay, but they make families and so on. And each time they get some data, they have an iterative process so that the virtual population looks as much as possible to the sample they have to test. So they try to make this virtual population as real as possible. And so they have, of course, no expertise in this statistical method. And I had in mind to have some analogy with the space-based population, because you know only some of them, the only ones which are followed regularly, big enough to be followed. But when there is an explosion, you follow a few objects, and you have all the odds, especially the smallest one, the different value of the coefficient A over M, which are different kinds of debris. You have the small ones, big ones, and so on. And you cannot follow by telescopes or radio and so on, all of them. So we decided to try to create a synthetic population of space debris. Maybe to reproduce, for example, an explosion, or to simulate a collision, and to see where the debris are going on, not only the one we are going to observe after, but all of them. It can help doubling the population, giving a huge value of air over land, etc. And we have the TLE, so the two land segment, with their data to control this synthetic population. So it was a collaboration of two PhD students. This is normally the objective of the institute, to bring together people from different disciplines. And Alexis and Lorian Dumont collaborated, and we had first results, which seems to propose something. So the method they use is the same as for the Belgian population. It's called iterative proportional fitting. So it's an iterative process for weighting data, describing the population up to the convergence of a stable state. And so they have to use a matrix formulation so that they have to discretize their data. And we're going to show you how the first simple results. So for example, they have a simulation after the satellite, the destruction of the satellite. So this is a representation in blue of the population which is simulated with the same properties in the same array at the population, the initial population, which is in orange. So you see that you make more elements in your population, but they are linked to the data there. So to have a synthetic population, which is a double of the one you have in the beginning. Is it correct? Yes, you answered me when so the convergence of the data could be efficient. Yeah, in the moment you have something similar to the real data. This is from the convergence trying to test. And so there is another test which I could show you. Is that you take the same event, but you divide the velocity rate by a factor 2. And so you can have, after the event rules in, what was the year of the event?
78.
So it's a long period, 2015. When you propagate your different bonds, and you see clearly that you have in blue in the first simulation, and then the second one with the velocity dispersion divided by 10, when you see the dispersion which is less important. So we seem to be ready now with the tool, with the implementation, to have a backlogical test simulating collision, explosion, ejection, changing parameters, changing the rules, and so on. Of course, it's not all the space debris population. This is not possible at the moment. But to reproduce and to try to play with, I would say, some events to predict some dispersion of debris and so on, I think we have a new tool still to be tested. And the difference of the blue, you have the population which is simulated in the beginning, and you have the synthetic population in orange. So, So, that's all I want to say about space debris. I'm again a little bit short of time, but if you have